Before we get to the monster blasting and jet packing of today's episode, I'd like to give big ups to our sponsor, which is Blast Brigade versus the Evil Legion of Dr. Creed. This is a brand spanking new Metroidvania which just entered Steam Early Access and is exploding with 80s cartoon charm. If you're like me, and I know I am, you enjoy having a search for the action in your games, but you never have to look far to find it in Blast Brigade. You've crash-landed on the island of the eponymous Dr. Creed and need to find dozens of new abilities for four distinct characters while defeating massive screen-filling bosses, all while delivering the occasional snide action quip. The island is composed of six secret-filled biomes where you need to solve devious environmental puzzles and grapple hook or blast through 30 different enemy types over the course of 15 hours of madcap mayhem. If you'd like to check it out, hit the link in the description below, and thanks again to My Games for sponsoring today's video. Welcome back to another episode of What Happened, the show that constantly evolves into... I can't even finish. That's the worst, most obvious segue ever! Yes, this week we are tackling the legendary failure that was Turtle Rock's Evolve, and using the term failure here brings me no pleasure, unlike some other games we've covered in the past. No, Evolve was set to turn the multiplayer genre on its head, with an exciting premise that had tons of potential from a respected studio on brand new exciting hardware, and it really didn't pan out at all in the long term. Like, at all. Like, at all. So strap on your jetpacks and get ready to spend a lot of money on DLC, because it's time to find out what happened to Evolve.
Oh, it's evolving!
Turtle Rock is an interesting studio. They were behind a lot of cool, innovative stuff. In fact, they were so good, they became an official part of Valve, the company that used to make video games that millions of people enjoyed worldwide.
Not that I wish to imply you have been sleeping on the job.
In fact, just before the release of the original Left 4 Dead, they were renamed to Valve South, an acquisition that was meant to get more product out on consoles. But it wasn't long before friction began generating between both companies. The logistics of communication and their game development ideologies started to clash. Turtle Rock was frustrated with Valve and the glacial pace in which they did everything. Say what? While Valve felt Turtle Rock didn't have enough staff to deliver the AAA experiences they were looking for, which seems a little weird, but they said what they said. And with all that said, it took a little more than a year before the inevitable split that saw Turtle Rock getting their name and independence back, although they lost a good percentage of their staff in the transition, while Valve retained the Left 4 Dead IP, therefore the founders of Turtle Rock essentially had to start over from scratch, and slowly began to staff up for a big upcoming project, one that had been rattling around in their collective mind palace for years, even before it was filled with zombies and witches. Its inspiration came from one of the most unlikely places imaginable. Remember when you'd go to GameStop or wherever, really, a gas station bathroom, and you'd see a million hunting games on the shelves? No, not those things. The real shit. Ah, yeah. Well, Turtle Rock co-founders Chris Ashton and Phil Robb were familiar with a number of the shoot bangs you see here, and thought they could evolve the genre into something more exciting. See? Oh, nailed it there! So much better. Anyway, it was something that the team realized they all had in common. They all knew at least one family member or friend that barely played video games but owned a Cabela's blankety blank, and realized that, as a concept, hunting had mainstream appeal, especially in America. I grew up in western Pennsylvania. My family was all hunters. I've been deer hunting, and the main thing I remember about deer hunting is sitting in 6 inches of snow, freezing my ass off. I never imagined that being a compelling experience on a computer. But the more we talked about it, being developers, we sort of start trying to problem solve. And it's like, what would make it fun? That's where we start talking about if the deer could fight back. If it was something dangerous, it would be more interesting. And the ideas just sort of start to snowball from there, all the way to where we get to the point where we like start referencing things like King Kong and Predator, and it's this group of guys fighting against this one super powerful beast, and what a cool experience that would be in a game. Turtle Rock, however, quickly realized that such a concept simply wasn't going to be possible with the technology available at the time, or would fall short of what they were envisioning. Online console multiplayer was just starting to explode in the early 2000s, so having 4v1 with a huge monster and two very different types of gameplay was just out of the range of technical possibility. Thus, they shelved the idea and took the opportunity to make Left 4 Dead for Valve, which was probably for the best at the time, as that franchise put Turtle Rock on the map and cemented their reputation as an innovator in the online co-op space. After those days of milk and honey were over and Turtle Rock had regained their independence from Big Daddy Gabe, they decided to return to that hunting idea that had gotten them hyped so many years ago. They wanted large, dense, realistic-looking maps, different control styles and gameplay for either side, and wanted Leviathan-sized beasts that could change throughout the course of a match. This worked out because around 2011, Sony and Microsoft started talking to developers about next-gen, so Turtle Rock felt it was all coming together. Oh, yeah. The first thing they needed to do was roll up the old sleeves and figure out which engine best suited the project, and since they had grown very familiar with Source, they decided to start there. They began by building a lush alien jungle planet and immediately stopped as they realized it was something Source really sucked at doing. More natural environments were not really considered when the engine was originally designed, thus Turtle Rock would need to look elsewhere. Was there any engine that did jungles particularly well? No, not really. Except there absolutely was. Turtle Rock landed on CryEngine, of course, which is most famous for powering Sonic Boom, amongst some other titles. Jokes aside, it was a good match for their concept, and fortunately, in a refreshing change, it seems CryEngine didn't really present any big problems for the team. You know what did present some big problems for the team, though? Partnering with THQ on the eve of their bankruptcy. Evolve started development sometime in 2010, whereupon they were approached by THQ, who very much wanted to publish, as it was going to be the cornerstone of their mature-rated push that was far too little and way too late to save the company. I somehow don't think Devil's Third was going to keep the lights on. THQ stopped funding projects and went into Chapter 11 in late 2012, and unfortunately, progress on Evolve also slowed down.
Way down.
And entered a holding pattern as it was one of those properties that was up for auction for other pubs to gobble up. And gobbled up it was. Take-Two Interactive / 2K Games became the new IP owners. And while this wasn't seen as a bad move at the time, it could have been Bethesda, it would have, some ramifications down the line. Once 2K had officially acquired it, the game started to go through many iterations as Turtle Rock started experimenting to see what would work and what wouldn't. Originally, Hunters, the team of brave souls tasked with taking down the gnarly space beasts, had a variety of secondary items that would aid them in fighting their prey. However, during extensive playtesting, Turtle Rock found that most people just mained the jetpack, as it provided the most options and freedom of movement. Thus, they decided that the pocket rocket would become the default piece of equipment, although this change would have a ripple effect against the menagerie of monsters they were designing, as it presented even more balancing issues. Speaking of the lineup of Monstars, well, Turtle Rock had originally designed them with a much more different aesthetic, going for more of an abstract Lovecraftian feel where you were never quite sure what you were looking at. Personally, I would have preferred that, just saying, but in the end, they wound up taking much more familiar shapes which would have better readability during gameplay. Even after that change in art direction, there were still a number of beasties that, while they did make it to playable form, for a variety of reasons, didn't make the cut. Which, as we all know, is the easiest part of the creative process.
Wendell is cut. Rudy is cut. Janie, you're gone. Steven, I like your hustle. That's why it was so hard to cut you.
There was the host / parasite, a yucky bug thing that could send out smaller, yuckier bug drone things which would go through the map to attack players. Very cool concept, but ultimately undone by the fact that the drones added such complexity to the design where their pathfinding would often break and would just attack random wildlife present in the maps. When Turtle Rock tried reducing the amount of wildlife, a key part of monster gameplay, just to try to get it all to work, well, that's when they knew that the parasite was not long for this world. At the end of the day, it just wasn't worth it. All the problems, all the things that weren't working. It started getting really geeky. Players wanted control over what the parasites did, so they had a bunch of commands telling them to guard or go to attack or to move here. It sort of started becoming a different game, and it wasn't very approachable. The Goliath monster, which did make it into the final game, started life as a grumpy Mr. Krabs-style creature, known affectionately as Grabberclaw.
Show me your tentacles! What?! I want to see empty suction cups!
He had two large claw appendages with different abilities that brought up a bunch more design issues. In playtests, he wouldn't throw the hunter, he'd just hold on to him. One time, this guy just grabbed a hunter, held on to him, and walked into deep water just far enough that the hunter was underwater and just stood there and drowned him. That was one of those abilities that people started abusing, where it was fun for about a week, and then it started getting really unfun. In addition, he also had the ability to yeet hunters into the air, which was fine for a while, but had to change when the jetpack was standardized, making the ability pretty much useless. And with all that, Mr. Grabberclaw went through the design ringer until it became the Goliath. So clearly, while there were a lot of problems to solve, it was an exciting time for the team, thinking and designing on their feet within this new multiplayer dynamic, trying to balance everything so it was both fun and live up to their vision. Evolve was publicly announced in the January 2014 issue of Game Informer, and was fast positioned as one of the biggest next-gen third-party games, with flashy headlines like, "From the creators of Left 4 Dead," and "Hot Monster Girl Action," just "Hot Monster Action," and probably the most confusing one, 4v1. While certainly some other games had flirted with the concept before, this is the first big title that made it its central focus. It was something that needed a bit of explanation, so much so that it was even incorporated into the logo. Later that year, it made a big splash at E3, where it won several awards like Best in Show and Best Console Game. So things were starting off well. 2K then took the opportunity for a giant circle jerk, of course, pointing to the trophy case of awards it was garnering before the game was even out, and boldly stated that Evolve continues to solidify its position as one of the most anticipated games of the year. The accolades for Evolve highlight the excitement and desire for new IP on next-gen systems, and we are poised to deliver what we believe will be the defining next-gen experience of 2014. Until the game got delayed to 2015, of course. And yes, while it was a defining next-gen experience, it was not for the reasons 2K or Turtle Rock had meant. Leading into launch, the game certainly was anticipated, but it also presented a barrier of entry to any gamers who wanted a story, exploration, or compelling characters. Yes, you could play the game offline with bots, but there was no real narrative or linear progression through levels. You either played as a monster or a human and tore each other up in a multiplayer setting. What's more, or worse, is that 2K let the slobbering space monster cat out of the bag really early, assaulting players with a swath of buying options, which really helped kick off that premium pre-ordering trend that, well, we still deal with to this day.
Pre-order! Preload! Pre-com!
There was a season pass, of course, a deluxe version and a PC monster race version. The pass included 4 additional hunters and a set of magma skins for the beasties. Confusingly, the deluxe version had that content, but also the behemoth monster. Kinda weird, isn't it? Why call it the season pass if it had the least amount of content? And then there's the monster race edition? Don't get me started. Cause despite its name, it didn't have its own monster, it just threw in 2 exclusive hunters. Why not call it the hunter race edition then? It was a bit of a mess, as you can surmise. Fans were understandably concerned about the DLC-heavy model, a concern that was repeatedly brought up to Chris Ashton, who allayed, citation needed, those fears by saying, "It will have the best DLC support ever. With Evolve, we made these modular pieces. The way the whole game fits together means we can make new maps, new environment types, new wildlife, new monsters and hunters, and all that stuff just plugs into the game. We're definitely looking to see how the community reacts. It's designed to have a long life. Hopefully that works and we get to try a bunch of crazy things with the community after release. As long as the people are into it and the DLC does reasonably well, then we'd like to keep making more. At the end of the day, it's a business and it has to make sense. But we believe that we've built a game that does support that really well, more so than any game ever before. Spoilers, it didn't do reasonably well. Less than 5 months later, the second season pass was released and featured more hunters and one new monster, but this was an entirely separate purchase and there was no option to buy monsters or hunters individually. Then there's the issue of maps. Both 2K and Turtle Rock were clear in saying that the maps would be released for free, but the problem there was that the maps didn't really increase the game's value or change up the gameplay in any significant way. It was the characters and their abilities which did. Now, while this might all sound familiar to a lot of you today, considering the ecosystem we now find ourselves in, the fact remains Evolve was one of the first and certainly one of the biggest that pushed this model really hard. The fact that season passes didn't encompass much of the actual DLC at all was the main issue, and drew ire from many, so much so that the game quickly garnered an overwhelmingly negative rating on Steam. Even the general critical response from review outlets was mixed, with most of that mixing stemming from its DLC model and lack of content at launch, but even the core game had some issues. Its maps, which were all really similar to one another, didn't really add any variety into the matches, and the progression slash unlocking systems were deemed a laborious grind. Another big issue was the game's patches, or lack thereof. Just things like simple balancing and bug squashing were released at a snail's pace, and this mostly came down to an issue of cost, apparently, as the game simply wasn't bringing in all that much. It managed to be the second highest selling game in February of 2015, as it was outsold by the 3DS remake of Majora's Mask, so yeah, not exactly the hardcore gaming season. It's been estimated, in that launch month, it moved around 300k, substantially less than a lot of AAA games and certainly a lot less than what 2K was expecting. Matthew Colville, a writer at Turtle Rock, lamented the slow rollout of patches and fixes, and while the reasons for their infrequency are not exactly known, he alludes it was 2K's decision. I sincerely believe there was nothing wrong with Evolve at launch that we couldn't fix if we could update the game live. We had a great launch, tons of people were playing it. They discover exploits and we couldn't do anything about it. As news of these exploits propagated, the user base evaporated. We had local fixes, often in 24 hours, couldn't deploy them, it cost too much, so folks who liked it couldn't get their friends to buy it, and we couldn't update the game to make the people playing it happy. When patches did roll out, they would be interspersed every 3 months, an eternity in this day and age, and as the player base dwindled, either out of boredom or aversion to buying more DLC, drastic measures needed to be taken. After 16 months of bleeding players, in July of 2016, 2K and Turtle Rock announced Evolve was going free to play and would be rebranded as Evolve Stage 2. More changes, tweaks, as well as a bunch of new hunters and monster skins. Now, rather sadly, Evolve Stage 2 didn't even last long enough to make it to consoles, as the switch to free-to-play didn't push the needle. Just 3 months later, 2K announced they were pulling the plug on the whole shebang, an expensive experiment that absolutely did not pay any dividends. Now, some of you might be asking, why wasn't the game free-to-play to begin with? Surely that might have been the better choice in hindsight? Well, Matthew Colville agreed. Getting your friends to spend a total of $240 on a game is a hard fucking sell. Give the game away, charge people for cosmetic stuff, and make the game free. Maximize your user base. We knew this, and THQ knew it. Alas, THQ went tits up. This, in a roundabout way, confirms that making the base game full price and then charging for a mountain of DLC was distinctly a 2K thing. And just like that, in less than 2 years, a game positioned to be the next big thing from a respected developer and a giant publisher was just gone. While it can still be played today through peer-to-peer, it hasn't seen any updates in the last 5 years. And in those 5 years, Turtle Rock maintained a very low profile, releasing several Oculus Quest titles that don't even have Wikipedia pages. That was, of course, until the recently released Back 4 Blood, which, let's not kid ourselves, is a pretty straightforward retreading of Left 4 Dead, which, when you consider the dice they rolled on Evolve, was probably the much safer bet. It's a shame because the core concept was always really strong, and the moment-to-moment gameplay pretty damn fun. But fortunately, the idea did not die with Evolve. The 4v1 genre is very alive today. See you next year, behavior! And if Evolve had released much later, it would have fit right into today's marketplace. But instead, it took the majority of the mudslinging right out of the gate with a monetization-heavy model that we are now literally assaulted with every single day. If you know of any other monstrously mismanaged multiplayer misfires, let me know in the comments below, over on my Twitter, or jetpack over to the Flophouse VIP Patreon, become a big boss, and nominate what you'd want to see in the future. See you next time, and thanks for watching!